Welcome back. Today we will start with NCERT Economics Class 11, the fourth chapter, where we'll be discussing about poverty. Now, when we talk about the key challenges of the society, there are three important challenges that the society face. It's poverty, infrastructure, and development. And today our sole focus would be understanding on poverty. These are the key terms that we would be covering in this lecture. And the most important thing about this lecture is the terms and the contents that we would be specifically discussing here are very, very conceptual. So make a note of those very carefully. Now, if we talk about India, India has the highest human capital in the world. And since we have a huge number of population, which we can say could be skilled or can be skilled, we need to provide opportunities for employment. So there have been various approaches along the various five-year plans and later on in the Niti Aayog, where we have worked around the development in the poverty in case of India. Now, if we look onto a global picture, nearly 1/5 of the total poor live only in India alone, and that's a huge figure we need to tackle on. At the eve of the independence, Jawaharlal Nehru said that we need to fight the issues of poverty, ignorance, disease and inequality from the country. And still we are struggling with those issues. So there need to be some kind of urgent mechanism that could bring a relief to this. If we talk about how the cycle of poverty works, let's understand there is a poor household. Obviously, if the household is poor, they won't have ample of food supply. So this little food supply would lead to issues of disease, malnutrition. This disease or malnutrition would affect the productivity. So the productivity of an individual would decrease. Since the productivity would decrease, again, it would impact the income. There would be lesser income than before. The self-esteem of the person will drop and the number of dependent people would increase in the society. And within the household, even the child and the elderly who are considered as dependent would be further more dependent or would be a further burden on the family. So this is a kind of vicious cycle which works on, and we can say the trap of poverty ever increases and the poor gets into the trap of poverty and the poor gets more poorer. So even among the poorer, we talk about the poorest of the poor, that is upliftment of the lowest section among the poor, and that is through the mission Antodaya that we say, where we try to uplift the poorest of the poor. Now government has brought in various schemes for this. When we talk about the direct benefit transfer scheme, which is the DBT scheme, it talks about financial inclusion. So financial inclusion is one of the important parameters that we say is very, very important to rule out the issues of poverty in India. Similarly, to work around the issues of diseases, we need to have another scheme that works for the healthcare. And recently for the 2018-19 budget, you have the Ayushman Bharat. That's the basic healthcare or the universal healthcare for the BPL families now. So those are some of the efforts that have been done by the government to bring out the issues of poverty or rule out the issues of poverty from the society. So we'll discuss about all these one by one as we move forward. Now, for now, let's understand who is classified as poor. There has been n number of criteria or categories under which we say this criteria is being met. So we can say a person who lives in a kacha house, a person who is illiterate, unemployed, does not have a basic standard of living, cannot meet the requirement of food on a daily basis, is suffering from hunger or starvation. So all those criteria are some of the criteria based on which you can say a person is poor. Now, when we say what are the key aspects of poverty, we have five basic key aspects that we cover under it. First is definitely, since there is poverty, the capital formation is very, very low. There is lack of infrastructure that is present. The demand becomes very low because obviously to meet the demand, you do not have ample of resources. There is high pressure of population that is present, and the social net basically weakens out with poverty. Now, Dadabhai Naroji did a very interesting study to talk about poverty levels in India. So what he considered was an idea of a jail. Now what he said was basically a person who is living in jail, the cost of that living would determine the level of poverty. So let's say of the total population we have nearly one third as the children. So you remove that one third population, you just work on this two third population, which is adult, and this population would consume a full amount of diet. However, this one third population, which is children, could be further divided into one sixth population, which is children under the age of 1 year or smaller children, who do not consume food, and the remaining children, the remaining one sixth of the children, who would consume half the amount of food as the adult does. So combining all these three, we would have a total of 3/4 that would be generated. And what he said that average poverty line can be explained as 3/4 of the total cost of living in a jail on a daily basis. So that's what he tried to explain. So Dadabhai Naroji's definition for poverty line was really interesting. It was the first effort made in India to explain the poverty lines in India. And what he believed was, since the jail prices would be the most considerable prices or the most minimal prices, we could say, during that time, the menu of the prisoners or the food that the prisoners had was considered as the baseline. And if the person cannot even have a 3/4 of that, that really explains the situation of poverty in India. However, later on, this idea of poverty line changed, and you had the various committees which recommended the different issues on poverty, which we would be discussing towards the end in this lecture. The most common method that we say now is based on the calorie values. So calorie consumption, we say it's 2400 for the rural area and 2100 for the urban area, and that's the most standard amount of consumption by an individual, which determines the poverty line. So below this level, we can say if the calories are not even this much, we can say a person is below the poverty line. So those are some of the basic parameters that we have tried to understand. Now let's categorize the poverty. Poverty can basically be categorized into two: absolute poverty and relative poverty. So when I say absolute poverty, I say rupees 100 per day should be the minimum level of income that a person should earn. Now if a person is earning below that, that means, or his income is below that, that means he is living below poverty. And that is how we calculate or we explain the absolute poverty. So we are measuring it in absolute terms. It should be 100, 200, 500, whatever be the number. However, when we talk about relative poverty, the scenario is much more different. Let's say a person is moving on a cycle, but all his neighbors are moving with a scooter. So then we can say the person A is, or he might believe that he is in relative poverty to all his neighbors. On the other hand, slowly and gradually he progresses well. He now has a scooter. When I say this person has a scooter, but all his neighbors now have cars, then again he or she might feel that there is a relative poverty, because he is still on the scooter and the rest are on the cars. So that is how we explain relative poverty. So relative is associated with the issues of inequality in relation or in position to others. However, absolute is determined exactly by the numbers. So the next is the various categorization of poverty. So we say poor, non-poor, or below poverty line and above poverty line. Now this is the poverty line that we have drawn, which is in the dotted line here. Always poor would be always below the poverty line. Usually poor would be maximum time below poverty line. Sometimes they could have a good rainfall or something, and they could be above poverty line. They could have a wonderful crop, and therefore the farmer could go above poverty line. But usually they are poor. Turning poor is very, very important. Let's understand this very carefully. So I have the poverty line here. This season, the rain was not good, the weather was not good. As a result, you did not have ample of crops. So the person is lying below poverty line. Now suddenly you had ample of rainfall, good harvest. So the person goes above the poverty line. Now again what happens is this person witnesses or this region witnesses a drought or a famine condition. So this person again goes below poverty line. So it's a kind of wavy pattern that occurs, and that's known as churning poor or churning poverty. That's very important to understand. The next is occasionally poor, another very interesting phenomena. As you can see, this person is consistently above the poverty line. However, in certain point, he came below the poverty line. Now, how this could be possible? So, a person is well affluent, but let's say he invests in a lottery. He could not win that lottery and lose. So, what would happen? He would suddenly fall into the trap of poverty. And that's what we define as occasionally poor. And finally, you have non-poor who are always above the poverty line. So, those are the various classifications that we talk about under poverty. Now, as we said, the most standard classification to explain poverty line is based on the calorific consumption. However, later on, it was taken as the monetary value or the per capita expenditure. For 2009 and 10, it was 673 for rural and 860 for urban areas. Then you have other factors which are associated to poverty, which includes health, education, sanitation and water supplies. Now, how do we measure this poverty? There have been various tools to measure it. We'll be talking about four important indexes for this. The first is the head count ratio. The name denotes this very well. So you have the heads that you have to count who are basically living below the poverty line. So let's say I have a poverty line here. So how many number of individuals are below poverty line would be the head count ratio. Very, very simple. Now this ratio does not denote the severity of poverty. The next is poverty gap ratio. Understand this carefully. Very interesting concept. Let's say a region or a country has the poverty line as rupees 100 per day. I have two regions, A and B of the country, and I have the individuals with their per capita daily wages. So let's say here it's 80, 80, 100, 120, 150. Here it's 40, 80, 100, 120, 180. Now all these values which are 100 and above would be simply ignored. What we would take into account is these values. Now, in the first case, in the case of A, I can calculate it as 100 minus 80 divided by 100 plus again 100 minus 80 divided by 100 plus 0000 for the remaining would be the poverty gap ratio for A, and then similarly I'll calculate it for B. But the idea here is, in case of B, this one person is extremely below the basic poverty line. As a result, to feed this person or to sustain this person, a lot of input from other people would move in so as to make him reach at least 80 and then definitely 100. That's what we want them to reach. So idea is to bring this person who is at a line of 40 to 100. So let's understand it this way. You have a poverty line. Now this region A, the person is here. But in the region B, the person is here. So the severity is this much in the first case and the severity is this much in the second case. Therefore, for poverty gap ratio, we explain that we try to understand the depth of poverty, how deep or how intense is the poverty, and for the same reason, we take into account the issues of severity. So that's how we understand the poverty gap ratio. Squared poverty gap ratio is again the same thing. What we do is we sum the square of the weights. So all the weights of the poverty gap ratio would be squared and summed together to find the squared poverty gap ratio. But the important thing here would be, again, it would again measure the severity, and since it's the square, it would measure the intensity in a much severe way, and therefore squared poverty gap ratio is also known as severity index. The next thing that we would be discussing is the SANE index. Now, SANE index has been discovered by Amartya Sen, who won the Nobel Prize for his work on welfare economics. His work has been very, very important. What he did was, he took the headcount ratio, he took the poverty gap ratio. So, it talked about numbers, it talked about the depth of poverty. Along with these two, he included the distribution of poverty. So, with these three parameters, he created his own index, which was known as the SANE index or the Amartya Sen index. Now, this is something that's very, very important that we have discussed, very conceptual. So, make sure you are well versed with it. The next is some of the statistics from the census and the various NSSO surveys. So we have the level of people living below poverty line in India for the various time frames. This would be available in the handouts. This is something you must remember. The statistics is important part of Indian economics. So just go through that. Now the causes of poverty. Causes of poverty, as we said, first of all, unemployment is one of the major cause, because if the people do not get employment, they won't have the income sources. As a result, the trap of the poverty would further increase. The indebtedness. Now, how does this indebtedness arise? Let's say a farmer is trying to bring in a crop, but for harvesting or for producing that crop, he needs certain amount of money. So he takes a loan, but unfortunately, the scene that year is not good. There is a drought. And with that drought, what happens is, he cannot repay his loan. Next year, he again has to take the loan for the crop. And that's how his loan accentuates. So one loan over the other. And that's why we call it as indebtedness. Unequal distribution of the wealth, again very, very important. So that's what we would be discussing under the section on income, where we would be discussing more under Gini coefficient and the inequalities in income. The next is colonial past. Now, what happened during the British rule in India? We had the raw material that was sent to Britain, and we had the finished product that was coming into the market. So, Indian market was flooded with British goods, and Indians were forced to buy that British good at whatever prices it was available. So, it affected the Indian market severely and definitely brought in a trap of poverty for India. So colonial past is one of the major factors that affected the issue of poverty in India and the other colonial nations as well. Then you had the limited resources, the weak institution, a lot of corruption, because so far there was no direct benefit transfer. So all the money was moving through the intermediaries, and it was not directly going into the account of the one who requires it or who is meant for it. So all these factors affect the or cause the poverty. Now, when we talk about aggregate poverty, it's basically the sum of individual poverties. So aggregate poverty is defined as the sum of individual properties, and these are something that should be noted in this chapter. Very, very important. Now, talking about the rural and the urban scenario. Now, urban area mostly have the people moving in from the rural area for work. Now, since you have the people moving in from the rural area for work into the urban area, they are mainly in the form of casual laborers. So it affects the poverty in that area, or it basically brings in the poverty in the urban area. In the rural area, sorry, you have people living on subsistence. So they are basically growing only for their needs. They do not have extra production which they can sell in the market and earn. The next is fragmentation of the land. So when we say fragmentation of the land, let's understand it in the simple way. So this was the land that the grandfather had. This land got divided into the four sons. Now within the sons, each son had their own children, and it was divided into, let's say he had four children, he had two, he has one. So this patch of land was divided into so many halves in the later years. Now this fragmentation led to, because of this fragmentation, what happened was the technology cannot be brought in for such a small piece of land, and what is being produced on such a small piece of land can only meet the subsistence requirement. It cannot be sold to the market area. So those are some of the drawbacks that we have seen over the years in the rural areas and the urban areas, which have brought in the issues of poverty further. Now, when we talk about approaches to deal with the poverty in India, we have three approaches that we would be discussing today. Under the first and the second 5-year plan, we basically talked about a growth-oriented approach. So our only focus was growth, growth, and growth. So what we said was we are working towards economic and social change. We are bringing in more economic development in the country, and this would affect the less privileged or the underprivileged. So our first and the second 5-year plan focused only on growth. The third 5-year plan focused on various programs and policies. So with that, we start the various programs and policies for the upliftment of the poor. Now, these includes a common policy like MINAGRA that talks about minimum 100 days of guaranteed employment in the rural area. Then you have Swarna Jayanti Shahri Rozgar Yojana for urban areas. You have PM Rozgar Yojana, the Grameen Rozgar Yojana. So all those were basically employment schemes. Then you had the National Rural Livelihood Mission that was part of it, the Swarna Jayanti Shahri Rozgar Yojana, and those were the programs and policies that were brought in to uplift the rural poor and the urban poor as well. So that was the second approach. So the first approach was growth centered. The second approach was policy centered, bringing in more policies, more programs for the upliftment. The third approach that we talk about basically focused on one important aspect, and that was providing minimum basic amenities. So when we say minimum basic amenities, what does it mean? When I say minimum basic amenities, I mean that at least the person should have free education or subsidized education, subsidized health care, water and sanitation, that should be available. So to meet this minimum basic amenities requirement, you had the idea of midday meals scheme, integrated child development program. You had the public distribution system that came in. So all those were part of the third approach, which talked about minimum basic amenities. Later on, we also talked about financial inclusion by the PM Jan Dhan Yojana. We talked about healthcare with the Ayushman Bharat. We talked about the social security by the National Social Security Assistance Program for the destitute and the widows. Now, one of the case studies that has been discussed in this lecture talks about the ample cases of farmer suicide that is being heard off and on. Now, what are some of the important causes for that? Firstly, it's the crop failure. The farmer is not getting the amount that he should for his survival by selling the crops. The traditional seeds are being overtaken by high yielding variety of seeds. The public investment in this section has decreased. The cheaper imports that are coming in from other countries have affected the local market. So they have to decline their prices to meet the foreign imports, and as a result, they fall into the trap of poverty. So those are some of the factors that affects farmers. Specifically, we have seen these cases in the regions of Odisha, where you have commonly heard farmer suicide cases that are coming up. Now, talking about some of the committees on poverty. The first committee that we would talk about is Suresh Tendulkar Committee. Make sure it's Suresh Tendulkar, not Sachin Tendulkar. So this Suresh Tendulkar Committee talks about the calorie intake. So based on the calorie intake, you would estimate the poverty line. The next is NC Saxena Committee, which talks about the rural poor. You have Hashim Committee that talks about the urban poor. So one committee talking about the rural area, the other talking about the urban area. And finally, the C. Rangarajan Committee, which is very, very important, it explained the purchasing power parity. So the purchasing power parity determines the level of poverty in a region. With this, we conclude this lecture. We'll be coming in with more further topics in economics. Very, very important. Some of those are highly applicable for your contemporary issues as well. So stay tuned. Do subscribe. Have a very good day ahead.